Hi, welcome to How to Repair. Cooker oven selector switches, they're misused and misunderstood when it comes to working in conjunction with the thermostat. Manufacturers do not seem to be printing enough clear, decisive information on how to use these. These selector switches should never ever be used when the thermostat is already set to the temperature. Doing this can lead to the actual device failing much earlier than it should do. In this video, I'll not only be showing you how to test and replace these, but I'm going to explain now briefly why these items are failing so early. The selector switch is a device that has multiple contacts on it for sending power to the appropriate function that you're using on the oven. Let me explain. If you turn this to the fan oven setting, you are selecting a couple of contacts, one going through to the fan motor, one going through to the fan oven element. The fan motor is a low ampage device, meaning it does not consume much power. But a fan oven element may be drawing in excess of 8 amp. And actually, when you are rotating the selector switch with the thermostat already engaged, you are causing sparks on the contacts. And these can actually lead to burning of the contacts, distorting of the plastic, or even the cam melting in certain locations. If you look at the screen here, you can see a selector switch which has been started to be misused, and you can actually see the burning starting to take place. On this other selector switch, the damage is more clear. And on this last selector switch here, the damage was so bad that it nearly led to a fire. A selector switch should always be set first, prior to actually turning the thermostat on. But if you wanted to change to the grill function while cooking, because you may want to brown the food, it is very important that you turn the thermostat off first before turning the selector switch around to the grill setting, then turn the thermostat back on again. This will prolong the life of the cooker no end. Now, in this video, I'm going to be showing you how to diagnose faults with the selector switch and also how to replace it. Before we actually start stripping down the cooker to have a look at the selector switch, I wanted to explain the difference between the contact inside the thermostat and the multiple contacts on a selector switch. The contacts on a selector switch are designed to be able to carry load, but they are not designed to actually cycle. The thermostat contact is designed to come on when heat is required and disconnect when heat is not required. This contact is a much heavier contact than the contacts inside the selector switch. If you are disconnecting elements while rotating a selector switch, the contacts will get hot, and this leads to the damage that can happen. It does not matter if you have a freestanding cooker, a built-in double oven, or a built-in single oven. There are multiple different variations of selector switches and manufacturers that they come from. Depending on the make of your cooker, you need to use your full identification number off the cooker to purchase a new selector switch if it's faulty. But to test these is not that complicated, but you really need to be able to get a good visual inspection. As the terminals on the selector switch, you need to closely inspect that there is no charring or burning on the actual contacts themselves. You can also do this with a multimeter. Using a multimeter is straightforward. If you look at the terminal connections on this side and the terminal connections on this side, you will see that it runs on the actual cam and on the set of points. We would be able to test that in the open position that there's no power going through, and in the closed position there is power going through. So we've just selected this terminal and we want to test across it. And I'll zoom in on the camera here for you. And here we have our multimeter. Turning our multimeter onto continuity, turning it on, we can now connect the terminals up on either side. I'm connecting on number 1 and P1 on this selector switch. And we should have continuity going across that terminal. It is very important that you've got good continuity going across the actual connection. You would need to do this for each individual connection to make sure that when you're rotating the cam, that the actual terminal goes down into the closed position and then retest on each individual one, as I'm doing here. To gain access to the selector switch will vary massively depending on what type of cooker you have. Freestanding cookers with ceramic hobs or gas hobs, sometimes you have to disassemble the whole cooker to gain access to the control panel. With built-in double ovens and single ovens, the cooker has to come out of situ, and I'm not going to bore you with that. We've got over 500 videos on our channel to assist you in individual makes. But we need to turn the cooker around, and you will also need to disassemble the cooker. I've already done this on this one, so I can just lift the lid off. Now, I've brought the cooker down to ground level so you can see. We have all the components around the cooker: cooling fan, grill element, fan oven element round the back here, fan motor and base element. And the selector switch controls all these features. It also is connected to the thermostat, which is on this side. The thermostat is normally what only controls the element with regards to regulating the temperature. The selector switch has to be dismantled to actually inspect it correctly. And to do this, you would need to actually pull the knob off the cooker at the front. And then there are two screws behind the control panel here, which hold the selector in place. I do suggest not only taking a detailed photograph of all the connections on the selector switch. And if I zoom in for you here, if you look very closely, there are multiple coloured wires. And sometimes there is more than one blue wire, for example. There's 1, 2, 3, 4 blue wires on this actual selector switch. So sometimes it's a good idea to actually get yourself some sticky tape, which you can write on, and actually put the individual numbers to the selector switch on the wire so you get the wires put back in the right place correctly. We will supply wiring diagrams where we can, but some manufacturers are very finicky about giving the information to the general public. They only want the information for their own engineers. Other manufacturers are very helpful when it comes to supporting customers with their machines, and they will supply the information. Okay, once you've taken the knob off and undone the screws, you will be able to take the selector switch away. And I don't want to repeat myself, but I'm going to. Do take a photograph. Identify each individual wire. Make sure you don't lose track of which connections they go on onto the selector switch. The most common question I get asked on the website is for help with regards to rewiring these selector switches. And on some occasions, I can't help because the manufacturers will not even give me the information. So when it comes to taking the wires off, just be very careful. One by one, take them off and identify them. Then we have the block connectors. These sometimes can be very tricky to get off. I sometimes use a small screwdriver or a hook screwdriver and go underneath it, lifting the terminal up slowly on each side to try and prise away the actual connections. They can be very, very sticky, these things. They're not easily fitted and not easily removed. And if I'm having trouble, trust me, you will. Once you've got the selector switch away, you are then able to go across each of the contacts. This selector switch is very different to the selector switch we were working on. It's a different design and it has actual different connectors. So the only way you can actually test this one is with a multimeter, anticipating which points are for which while rotating the cam. Okay, now we've got the selector switch. I just wanted to show you the differences between the one I was explaining earlier and a new type selector switch. They are very different in the way that they are constructed. The new ones have a different connection system. They're still points, but they are very, very small points hidden in behind this plastic. And you have to look in detail when rotating the knob around to understand how the actual pins go down that are joining from the one side to the other side. So they are more complicated to test, but normally if you've got a damaged selector switch, you can visually see it straight away. There will be burning on there. But if you have to do tests across each individual contact, they are much harder to test while you're trying to work out the configuration. And the big problem with these things, even though I have got reasonable vision, okay, I got these things on my head, I still have to use a great big magnifying glass to be able to identify the numbers that are written on this selector switch. The manufacturer has been very good. They've even put the part number on here, which is 26310055. So they've given us the part number. But without this great big magnifying glass, I defy anyone to be able to read half of the information that's on this selector switch. It is just microscopic. Anyway, that's my rant over with. Thank you very much indeed for watching this video. By the way, if you do need to replace it, just follow the procedure in reverse. And remember, you can always buy the parts off us, and we have over 500 videos on the YouTube channel now to assist you in all your appliance repairs. And if we really helped you, you can always click on the Buy Paul a Beer page to support the website. Not only do we sell parts, we supply the information to assist you in the future. Thanks very much indeed for watching.
How to repair shows you how to fix them now. How to save cash by repairing it now. Got the parts, we'll show you how DIY fixing started now. Washing machines, cookers, ovens, dishwashers, extractors, hobs, fridges, freezers.